Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. I'm Nick Barber. Coming up on this week's show, pay changes at Foxconn, big news from Apple, and a super thin laptop. On Monday, Apple CEO Steve Jobs took to the stage and introduced the company's latest offering, the iPhone 4. The phone is 9.3 millimeters thick, and according to Apple, that's 24% thinner than the iPhone 3GS. The phone's antennas are built into the case and support GSM, 3G, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, and GPS. In addition to a traditional camera on the backside of the device, there's now one on the front for video conferencing, a feature Jobs was excited to show off with Apple designer Johnny Ive.
Hey, Johnny. Hey, Johnny, how you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
FaceTime, as it's called, is only available on iPhone 4s and over Wi-Fi for now. The screen on the phone is 3.5 inches and has a resolution of 960 by 640 pixels. With a two-year AT&T contract in the U.S., the 16-gigabyte phone will cost $199 and the 32-gig model will be $299. Pre-orders start on June 15th. And the phone will ship on June 24th to the US, France, Germany, the UK, and Japan. By the end of September, it will be available in 88 countries. Monday's demo wasn't all fun, though. Jobs had a tough time dealing with keynote tech glitches.
Our networks in here are always unpredictable, so they're a little, have no idea what we're gonna find. They are slow today.
The presentation of the new phone was dogged with problems as a result of airwaves crowded with Wi-Fi signals.
You know, you could help me out if you're on Wi-Fi, if you could just get off. I'd appreciate it. We're having a little problem here. I don't know what's wrong with our networks.
When it couldn't get on Wi-Fi, one of the phones tried and failed to connect to AT&T's much criticized 3G network.
There we go. Yes, I know that. I don't want the cellular data network. Well, geez, I don't like this.
Jobs said that the problem was that 570 Wi-Fi base stations were operating in the keynote room, and because the iPhone 4 can only make use of the 2.4 gigahertz Wi-Fi band, there were only 3 non-overlapping channels available. Continuing with some more tough news, a glitch on AT&T's website has exposed the email addresses of more than 110,000 iPad buyers. The data was downloaded by a hacking group known as Goatsy Security, which obtained the information after stumbling upon a program on AT&T's website that would send back the iPad user's email address when given a unique SIM card identification number known as an ICCID, or Integrated Circuit Card Identifier. By guessing ICCID numbers, the hackers were able to download 114,000 email addresses. AT&T said that it fixed the problem on Tuesday. Prior to that, Gawker, the site that first reported the news, found email addresses belonging to major celebrities and politicians. Foxconn, one of the world's largest contract manufacturers, plans to raise pay for its workers at its plant in Shenzhen, China. They hope that that will put a stop to a string of suicides that's been such a problem at the campus's main factory. The video you're seeing here is of protesters at last week's Computex. Foxconn has become the focus of media scrutiny because of at least 13 people have attempted suicide at its factories in China. Foxconn's size and the list of popular products it makes also has put it in the spotlight. Monthly pay for frontline employees will be raised to 2,000 Chinese yuan, or about $292 per month, for those that pass a performance evaluation. The basic salary of Foxconn workers prior to the start of the raises was 900 yuan, or about $132 a month. Last week, our team was at Computex in Taipei, and we showed you a whole bunch of gadgets, but we didn't get to everything, so here's some more. Compal Electronics showed off one of the thinnest laptops ever, called the Ultra Slim Smartbook, which has an 11.6-inch touchscreen, an ARM or Intel processor, and is only 8.9 millimeters thick. By comparison, the MacBook Air tapers from 4 millimeters to 19.4 millimeters at its thickest point. Most of the computing circuitry is back near the hinge, where the screen meets the keyboard. In most laptops, that area is normally reserved for the battery, but Compal says it's designed a wide, thin battery to fit under the full-sized keyboard. The company also showed off another laptop so thin it doesn't even have a hinge. The 13.3-inch touchscreen laptop uses a thin, soft material for the display, allowing it to fold like a soft leather book. Both laptops should be out by October, but no price is set yet. Inventec put out its first mobile internet device that runs on Android. The Dr. I is a 4.8-inch touchscreen with a complete QWERTY keyboard, 1.3-megapixel webcam, and wireless internet. The device is expected to cost between $400 and $600 US. Acer managed to cram a 480p projector inside this 4-inch by 5-inch package. The projector can be connected via USB or HDMI and also has an SD card slot. It's expected to go on sale in July for around $460. At the recent Games for Health conference right here in Boston, we showed you the PlayStation Move motion controller. But the conference also presented gaming controllers for people with limited mobility. The Able Gamers Foundation and Evil Controllers built this prototype controller that allows people with disabilities to use it.
I think the controller itself is important because when you're disabled, sometimes you're bedbound, you're in a hospital, you're in a VA, and really video games are your escape. And controllers allow you to get to them.
The controller is obviously a very early prototype, and while there are no concrete plans for commercialization, Spahn said he hopes that it's the beginning of a more polished product. Well, that's our show for this week. Thanks for joining us here on World Tech Update. Coming up next week, we'll have all the news from the E3 Gaming Expo going on in Los Angeles. To find out what's coming up, follow us on Facebook and Twitter. As we head out this week, we'll give you a sneak peek at a super powerful desktop computer we built this week in Boston. I'm Nick Barber, and for all of us here at the IDG News Service, thanks for watching, and we hope to see you next week.